Dr. Rama Asaprama Hasho, the director of I International Buddhist Studies College. He respects the lecturers inside.
Yes. Dear brother and sister in Thai Plum Village Sangha, and all our brother and sister in Dhamma and thousands of online viewers around the world, today in the spirit of harmony and coordination, IBSC and Thai Plum Village organized a seminar on being this, the light and teachings of Zen Master Thich Nhat Hanh, the I encourage at my room in International Buddhist Study College in Thailand. Today I am Bikuni Chang Vinyi, the moderator of the seminar. Beginning of the seminar, I would like to invite you all to listen to the Plum Village Sangha chanting the Heart Sutta. Now we would like to Plum Village Sangha come and chant.
Recording in progress.
Contemplations before chanting. The Sangha is invited to come back to our breathing so that our collective energy of mindfulness will bring us together as an organism, going as a river with no more separation. Let the whole Sangha breathe as one body, chant as one body, listen as one body, and transcend the boundaries of a delusive self, liberating from the superiority complex, the inferiority complex, and the equality complex.
Emptiness and emptiness is not all. Blessed name. Blessed Sari Buddha, Prima Prima, 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 no defilement, no purity, no increasing, no decreasing. That is why in emptiness, body, feelings, perceptions, mental formations, and consciousness are not separate self-entities. Creating realms of phenomena which other six sense organs, six sense objects, and six conscious masses are also not separate self-entities. The tellings of interdependent, the rising and extinction are also not separate self-entities. You being the causes of your being, the end of your being, the heart, inside and attainment. Also not separate self-entities. Whoever can see this no longer needs anything to attain. Sattva who practice the inside that brings us to the other shore, see no more obstacles in the mind, and because there are no more obstacles in the mind, they become the ground of fear, destroy our perceptions, and realize perfect nirvana. All Buddhas in the past, present and future, by practicing the inside out, brings us to the other shore. Our evermore attending authentic and perfect enlightenment. Sariputta is true, we know that the inside that brings us to the other shore is the great mantra, the most illuminating mantra, the highest mantra, a mantra beyond compare, the true wisdom that has the power to put an end to all cries of suffering. Let us proclaim the mantra to praise the inside that brings us to the other shore. Gate, gate, para, gate, para, sangate, bodhisva. Gate, gate, para, gate, para, sangate, bodhisva. Gate, gate, para, gate, para, sangate.
Many thanks for the Thai Blambilis Sangha wonderful chanting in the beginning ceremony. Now I would like to invite Prabhupada, I would like to invite Prakupala Panya Warawas Hansa Tamahaso, Professor Doctor, the Director in IBSC Buddhist International Buddhist Studies College, giving us the opening speech. Now he will give the online because he has some ceremony outside. Ajahn Hansa, I know he's on the way, come here. So that's now we continue and ceremony. Now we would like to share a little bit with the biographies of the Zen Master Thich Nhat Hanh, because today the topic is about the lives of Thich Nhat Hanh and the lives and the teachings of Thich Nhat Hanh. Zen Master Thich Nhat Hanh, his name Nguyễn Xuân Bảo. He was born on 11th of October 1926 and passed away on 22nd of January 2022. He was a global spiritual leader, Vietnamese Buddhist monk, Buddhist activist, poet, teacher renowned for his powerful teachings and best-selling writings on mindfulness and peace. He is the founder of the Plum Village tradition. His historical recognized as the main inspiration for engaged Buddhism, known as the hero and developers of mindfulness. Zen Master Thich Nhat Hanh were a significant influence on Western practice of Buddhist and mindfulness. In the mid-1960s, he co-founded the School of Youth for Social Service and created the Order of Interbeing. He was exiled from his native Vietnam for almost four decades after expressing opposition to the war and refusing to take sides. In 1961, Thich Nhat Hanh traveled to the United States on a scholarship to study comparative religions at Princeton Theological Seminary. The following year went to teach and research Buddhism at Columbia University. Zen Master Thich Nhat Hanh has been a pioneer in bringing Buddhism and mindfulness to the West and establishing an engaged Buddhism community for the 21st century. Dr. Martin Luther King called him an apostle of peace and nonviolence when nominating him for the Nobel Peace Prize in 1967. Thich Nhat Hanh established dozens of monasteries and practice centers, spent many years living in Plum Village monasteries, which he founded in 1982 in the southwest France, Thénard. Traveling internationally to give retreats and Dharma talks, he promoted deep listening as a nonviolent solution to the conflict and shows the right deep awareness of the interconnectedness of all elements in nature. He called the term engaged Buddhism in his book with the title Vietnam Lotus in a Sea of Fire. After a 30-year exile, Zen Master Thich Nhat Hanh was permitted to visit Vietnam in 2005. In November 2018, he returned to Vietnam to his root temple, the Hieu Temple in Hue, where he lived until he passed away on the 22nd of January 2022 at 95 years old. Thank you for your listening. And now I would like. Okay, now Ajahn Han Sakham already in Zoom, and I would like to invite the Prakupala Panyavarawas, Hansa Thammahaso Professor Doctor, the Director of International Buddhist Studies College, give the opening speech. We respect this invite, Ajahn. Can you mute your microphone? Please open your microphone.
Recording in progress.
What happened? Good morning, everyone. Good morning, everyone. Do you hear me, right? Do you hear me? Do you hear me? I'm not quite sure if you hear me. Do you hear me? Are you mad? Đây nhìn vào. Đây nhìn vào. Đâu chia đây nhìn mấy. Hả? Đây nhìn mấy. Hả? Đây nhìn phụ mấy. Hả? Đây dân phụng ba. Đây dân phụng ba. Mới dân phụng ba thằng ngôn à. Hả? Hả? Đây dân phụng ba. Hả? Con thì nào đấy thì đi yên phụng ba. Ok. Tấn mới đi yên phụng mà thế nè. Cũng quên một lỡ nè.
Now we would like to invite the director of IBSC, Prakupalat Panyagwaro Hansa Thammahaso, Professor Doctor, give a lovely opening speech. We invite this you. We invite you.
Okay, do you hear me, right? Good morning, everyone. To me, I would like to thank Venerable Dr. Yulasa, Wise Director for Vipassana Tulak Affair. And you all come from the school of Most Venerable Tibetan from Khao Yai. So this is just good time for us who come to join hands in hand to organize international conference. Especially in order to dedicate our merit and goodness to most venerable master Thipathan. To me, So far, I have a chance to organize very such celebration in Thailand. Approximately 12 years ago, I have a chance to organize everything on behalf of Mahajula Lumpona, Yalayat University. Prepare everything for most venerable Master Thich Nhat Hanh, because we invite him to join with a celebration at United Nations Base Camp as a keynote speaker. And our rector, Professor Dr. Prabhupada Pandit, appointed me to take the best care of most venerable closely. That is the time for me to learn many things from most venerable. I have to prepare a lot. I have to prepare, for example, air ticket and most venerable unhappy to stay at hotel. So that's why we have to prepare Buddha Monthon Nakhon Pathom as a dormitory and invite most venerable and his disciple to stay there for 15 days of the year. After that, most venerable went to Chiang Mai. Went to Chiang Mai for 10 days, then come back to Bangkok. I have to organize and invite businessmen in Thailand to share experiences and knowledges with most venerable at Natok Sao Noi Nakhon Nayok. That one is that place is appropriate or appropriate for most venerable and businessmen, especially big companies. In time, the thing I learned from most venerable, the first one, I think most venerable take great effort to learn Buddha teaching. As of course, even most venerable learn Mahayana school, but Mahayana school there are too many Buddha teaching. It is the same Theravada, especially mindfulness in every state, peace in every state. Mindfulness is the beginning of mindfulness, of peace. Mindfulness is the foundation of peace, thing like that. So mindfulness is so important. The most many people stay in Vietnam, in America, even in France, he brought all disciples to follow the pin of the Buddha. And again, most venerable try to approve Buddha teaching. But eventually, most venerable have a lot of experiences. Because of this reason, come to the second reason, most venerable try this to dedicate his life to propagate Buddha teaching, because when most venerable approve already, approve mindfulness, concentration, and wisdom, and most venerable get benefit from experiences. After that, it's the time to propagate Buddhism and transferring Buddha teaching just as sati, samadhi, panya to disciples around. When we talk about disciple, not just in Vietnam, but everywhere is around the world, because I saw when most venerable being here, businessmen, and there are too many people in Thailand. They really love the way most venerable try to teach, try to inspire or motivate them. But sometimes I think that it's like in the present time. The way that Mahayana try to propose with the teaching to those who suffer, I think it's not appropriate anymore. But the way that most venerable master Thich Nhat Hanh try to inspire many people and bring them all to practice, that is just a good way they all so happy when they listen to Most Venerable Thich Nhat Hanh, and they all would be able to bring that teaching to practice and achieve true happiness. You know why? Because all Dhamma, everything or experiences come from doing meditation, come from doing mindfulness. So that's why when the Most Venerable coach or inspire or talk to many people, that's why they will be able to make that easy. And they have strong confidence when they have to bring Buddha teaching to practice in their life. And the last one I learned from Most Venerable, of course, like the Buddha. The Buddha tried hard to achieve enlightenment by practicing mindfulness, samadhi, and panya. And after he achieved enlightenment, or achieved nirvana, the Buddha going everywhere 45 years from that time, go to propagate Buddhism, teach many people, king or those who suffer, women, men, rich men, something like that. In India, 45 years. But eventually, it is our rule, it is the real rule. We are unable to go far away from death. All of us, even the Buddha and Most Venerable Thich Nhat Hanh, have to pass away one day. Even Most Venerable try best to dedicate his life to the Buddhist. But this rule, we are unable to go far away from. We all have to pass away. Of course, when Most Venerable passes, he inspired all our body, because our body comes from four elements. It is the thing that Most Venerable try to remind us. Our body comes from four elements. The first one, the soil, the second one, water, the third one, fire, and the last one is the air. Soil, water, fire, air consists of our body. Our body comes from four elements. The Most Venerable tried to explain to his disciple, of course, I pass away, but I still stay with you all the time. Back to nature, back to the air, back to the soil, back to the fire, back to the air, back to the water. So when you see me, it's the time to learn and understand what happened. That is the real Dhamma. I not go far away from you. I stay behind you. I stay beside you all the time. Don't cry. Just try to bring the way I teach you to practice in your life. Because the Buddha explained that there are two puja of two pay respect, paying respect. Puja, amisa puja, and patipat puja. Amisa puja means we pay respect to the Buddha. We give the robe, food, or candle. That's not the real puja. It's not the real respect in terms of Buddhism. The way to respect to the Buddha or the way to respect to Most Venerable Thich Nhat Hanh is the way to bring Buddha teaching and his teaching to practice in daily life. Whenever we understand the real teaching, it's the time to see who is Thich Nhat Hanh, who is Master Thich Nhat Hanh, who is the Buddha. So now we come to the right. You all organize international conference. Learn from the Buddha. Learn from Master Thich Nhat Hanh. Learn the way to practice Buddha teaching. Learn the way to apply Buddha teaching to use in their life. And learn how to propagate Buddhism. Too many people who suffer in the pandemic 19 or war, something like that. So once again, I would like to thank you all. Venerable from Plum Village at Khao Yai, my disciple, my student who study at International Buddha Study College, and all disciples of the Buddha around the world. Today, you have a chance to listen to them all and bring whatever you learn in order to remind you. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you, the most venerable Hansa Thammahasso Professor Doctor, the Director of IBSC. Very wonderful the speech. Yes, the Dance Master Thich Nhat Hanh not passed away. When the disciple any in other everywhere, he will manifest in his disciple and his Sangha. So that's now I would like to invite the Venerable Thich Nhat family. He is the elder brothers in Plum Village. He followed Dance Master Thich Nhat Hanh more than 27 years. He is the 27th of disciple Dance Master Thich Nhat Hanh. And he will become a monk when he 20 years old until now. And he received become the Dharma teacher in Plum Village around the world, not only in Thai, in America, in Vietnam, also in France. Many centers he came and had a wonderful Dharma talk, and he is the one symbol of Thich Nhat Hanh, that's Master Thich Nhat Hanh, the way he practiced. Manifest the way mindfulness and peace in his breath and his walking. Yes, thank you. Now we would like to invite Venerable Thich Nhat family come and to give share with us the topic, the life of Zen Master Thich Nhat Hanh, icons of peace and courage. Now I would like to invite brothers.
Put on this. Can you hear me okay? Put it on. I think we can turn it back on. Okay. Internet and Wi-Fi. All right. Okay. Just breathe and smile. This is a book, not a book, a biography of our teacher, Zen Master Thích Nhật Hạnh. We just published after 49 days of his passing away. And this is a very complete detail about his life. All you need to know about Zen Master Thích Nhật Hạnh authentically it will be in this book, and I think it will be translated into English and other language. Now it's become very hot in Vietnam. Become the hottest book in Vietnam right now, and many young people they cannot buy it because it's run out of. And talking about Master, our teacher, Thầy, we call him Thầy. Yeah. In 45 minutes, quite difficult. How you see how thick it is. Yeah. So if you are Vietnamese monk or nun, I think you can, when you go back to Vietnam, you can try to get one, because this is quite authentic, and there are a lot of things that people are miswriting about Thầy on the internet. Yeah. And many of them are from Thầy journals. Good morning, dear Mahasangha, dear venerable monks and nuns, and our lay friends. We are monks and nuns from Thai Plum Village, and we are very privileged and happy to be here with you today. And just review the life of our teacher, Thầy, who have just passed away a little more than 100 days. And just a few days ago, we organized a ceremony to spread the ash in Thai Plum Village. And we had invited many venerable monks from MCU and also local to come and pray for the ceremony. So sitting here today, I think I can feel that Thầy is sitting here with us, in all of us. And I remember I have the great chance to be close to Thầy and be his attendant for 10 years. And I'm very happy and feel lucky to have that chance. Not only learn from the Dharma, but also learn from the living Dharma, the body teaching by Thầy. I always remember that he always told us that a happy monk or a happy nun or a happy practitioner is the one who have a great love, yeah, great bodhicitta, the mind of love. Yeah. If we don't have that big mind in our heart, then it's quite difficult to realize the path and to be a happy monk or a nun or a practitioner. So the main purpose of the most talented as a monk or nun or a practitioner to Thầy is the one who is happy. It's not about knowing a lot of knowing in depth about the teaching, the Dharma, the Vinaya, the Shastra, but the one who is happy and free. So that is something that Thầy always had always reminded us. And if we are a happy monk or happy nun, a happy practitioner, we can contribute a lot to the world, to the society. We are able to transform, heal ourselves. We are able to help others, people, to transform, to heal themselves, and to be free from life sufferings and difficulties. So in our community, Thầy always remind us not to pay attention too much about what you know, but about how you are, about how you are, about are you happy enough? Are you a happy monk? Or you a happy nun? So today, this morning, the sharing, the presentation is about that. Sharing about Thich Nhất Hanh life and works. It's just about to remind us and to awake, to awake that seed, that capacity of love and compassion and of understanding. And we all do have that capacity inside. That is a vitality, kind of deep force energy that can always be cultivated. And in Buddhism, bodhicitta mind is the Buddha mind. Yeah. And if we have the bodhicitta strong in us, we can feel the Buddha in us in every action that we are doing. Because I am not the witness of Thầy's history. Yeah. I mean, part of it later on, but before that, during what he have done for Vietnam, during the war time, the conflicts and everything, most of us are not in that situation, and we cannot feel and breathe the air in that situation, that time. But we can learn how to review, yeah, so that we can learn something and we can touch the heart of Thầy, yeah, his love, his books for his people and for the world. So I think I will begin with when I was young. I know that many of us or many of you have known or read about him. But when he was young, he was inspired to become a monk. Yeah. Because during the French invasion, even he was very young, but he already witnessed war and conflicts and death around him. And he saw, one day he saw an image of a Buddha sitting on a grass on the front page of a magazine, Buddhist magazine, just sitting on the grass. And he saw that image, the Buddha is so peaceful, so relaxed, so free. And he was inspired to be like that, to be like a Buddha. And with that image, contrast to what he saw, what he experienced in daily life around him in the country, in the village, he saw people die, was killed by the French or vice versa. And he wanted to do something in order to help people to suffer less. That is the bodhicitta grow, start to emerge in the heart of a young boy. And he was also longing to look for so that image. He called it the hermit. And he knew that he had learned that nearby, in his home, there is a forest or a mountains that people said that there is a hermit lived in there. So he wanted to go there to look for the hermit.
Yeah.
And one day on a picnic day, he on his classroom, and they all went out for a picnic. And he tried to sneak himself up and into the mountain called Núi Na Mountain, in the north. And he was looking for a hermit, but he saw no hermit at all. And he was so exhausted and tired. So he saw a well. So he came there and he tried to get some water to drink from the well. And after drinking the water in that well, he felt so good. And he just lied down and slept for a little bit. Maybe he told us about a few minutes, but it was like a very long, deep sleep. And he felt completely peaceful and satisfied. And later on, he realized that is the hermit. The well is his hermit. He had met the hermit in a form of well, of a well, and he had drank the most tasty water, like a nectar of compassion, and he felt completely free and peaceful and satisfied. And that was his first experience of a spiritual realization. But he did not know. Yeah. And in 1942, he was born in Hue, Vietnam, but his family moved to the north because his father was appointed to go there to train soldiers to open new land.
Yeah.
So he studied in the north, when he was young. So in 1942, he started his. He was allowed by his parents to become monk. At the beginning, it's difficult, but later on, with his convince and his determination, and his elder brother also a monk, so he was supporting him to become a monk. So they agree to allow him to become a monk and send him to the Root Temple in Hue, in the central of Vietnam. So in 1942, he started his novice training. I just came back from there about more than a month. I went there for one year and a half to be with him until he passed away. So he was training as a young baby monk, a young baby monk, not a novice yet. A baby monk is the one who just enter the temple and get training in the very basic things. And normally you see them with a little bit hair here and here and here. Yeah. I don't know if Thay has that, but I don't see any picture like that. So 42, and then in 1945, he received the novice precepts. And during this time, he was training to be mindful of everything he do, drinking water or closing the door, opening the door, sweeping the ground, everything they do in mindfulness. So there is a book, Essential Vinaya Training for young monks and nuns. But he is really diligent in learning and study and very clever. So he doesn't need a lot of time in order to memorize the text and so on. And in 1947, he was sent to Bao Quốc Buddhist Institute, just nearby. And he studied further Buddhist teaching in Bao Quốc Institute. But after 2 years of learning, still a novice, and he also studied Buddhism theoretically. Meanwhile, he also still witnessed a lot of suffering around him, poverty, famine, when the Japanese entered Vietnam. So there was a big famine, poverty happened in Vietnam during that time. So, and there was a lot of people die as well. So he was thinking of, so how Buddhism can help this kind of situation? We cannot just study the Dharma, the teaching of Buddha theoretically, and then stay in the temple where people out there suffer a lot. So can Buddhism can do something in order to help? But it seemed that it's quite there's no way. Yeah. And then people are also get drawn into a kind of social conscious about young people, but Buddhism at that time does not have yet the answer for this kind of question, this kind of situation. And he believed that during the Tran and the Li dynasty in the 11th and 13th century, Buddhism during that time was really engaged into society and helping people to and the country to flourish and to stay strong and with the invasion of the Chinese. And monks, they give the way out for politicians in order to help the country with the wisdom and teaching of the Buddha. So at that age, about he became a monk at the age of 16. So when he was about 17, he already think of how to renew Buddhism, how to make Buddhism relevant to the modern, to the new situation, to the present situation, so that Buddhism is not like just a bonsai Buddhism. You know what bonsai Buddhism? It's just a bonsai in a vase, and it cannot grow.
Yeah.
And we only just enjoy the bonsai, but the bonsai cannot spread. And every time you just cut. So this is his master, Thanh Quý Chân Thật. And this is Tư Hiếu. You can see here Tư Hiếu. And this is the Bảo Quốc Institute, the one below.
Yeah.
So during 2 years training as a novice, he was not certified with the Buddhist study program there. And he think that besides studying Buddhism, monks also need to learn the about the situation, economic situation, the political situation, the what is happening, and the literature and the philosophy. He needs to know all of this in order to have enough skill in order to renew Buddhism and respond to the situation in Vietnam during that time. So he left with others, a few other monks with his age, and they moved to the south because he proposed to the Bảo Quốc Institute a certain thing that to help renew Buddhism, but it was refused. And his proposal were put in the table, on the table, in the drawer of the table. So he was not satisfied, and then he just bowed to the head of the institute, and he wanted to go south. So he went to Saigon, and in there he continued to explore, study, but mostly he told me that mostly he learned, he studied by himself. He spent a lot of time in the library, you know, reading and learning and study. So his time study in school is not so much. And that's why when he see his disciple like really study, learning by himself and not rely too much on class and school, he really like it. So he co-found a temple called Ấn Quang Pagoda. It used to be just a hut of wisdom. And then with Master Tihu, so they both run and then turn it into Ấn Quang Pagoda. I become a reformist Buddhist institute in 1950. So that where they learn about teaching of Buddhism and training monks and nuns, and try to do something in order to renew Buddhist teaching, a new way of training a young generation of monks and nuns. And then Ấn Quang slowly become, before that word Ấn Quang, Ấn is respond to the light, and then turn into Ấn Quang. So it's become, and he was the youngest Dharma teacher in that institute. Only I think about 20 years old or something. And very outstanding. So he was handed the responsibility to set up to draw a new program for Buddhist study and training for monks and nuns, a generation. So in 1951, Thầy received the full ordination as a bhikshu with a very famous master who is the Vinaya transmitter, Master Don Hong. Yeah. So during this time, he continued to rewrite and to give an idea about how to renew Buddhism. And he wrote many, later on it was published into like actualized Buddhism or modernized Buddhism and things like that. And so this is what he said. I was full of creative energy, an artist and a poet. But more than anything else, I wanted to help renew Buddhism in my country to make it relevant to the needs of the young people. So you see, his heart is always burning for that. Yeah. So in 1954, with July 1954, the French and the Vietnam government was signed the Geneva Accords. So during that time, Vietnam were divided into two, the North and the South. And this is the time that in Vietnam, there was a big confusion and uncertainties. And people are young, especially the young people, they don't know what is the way out for Vietnam. A lot of confusion, a lot of uncertainty, and also the idea of communists is really attractive. Yeah, so many are young, they also get drawn into that. And Thầy was invited to by a democracy daily news. His name is Vũ Ngọc Cát, the editor of that magazine, to write a few articles, 10 articles, about the situation and how Buddhism heritage can help shine the light for people to know the way out of Vietnam, because he knows that Thầy has strongly believed that Vietnam has the jewel, has the wisdom that handed down by the Buddha and many teachers over many generations during the Li and the Tran dynasty. So there should be a way out for that in order to help people to see clearly, to help Vietnam to get out of the confusion and uncertainty situation. So Thầy wrote 10 articles with the title A Fresh Look at Buddhism, because during that time, even intellectual people see that Buddhism is something out of date and cannot respond to the present situation. So Thầy wrote a series of 10 articles, and the magazine became very hot. Many copies were sold in a day, and many intellectual people also read. Many people read, the young people, and they feel hope, they feel a strong faith that Buddhism can do something in order to help the situation. So those articles already we can see the seed of engaged Buddhism, the vision for engaged Buddhism crystallized during that time. And in 1955, the Ngô Đình Diệm regime suppressed Buddhism in Vietnam. And there was an idea about personalism proposed propaganda in the country, and they also write about that, you know, to help people to see clearly that personalism is not the way for Vietnam. And you know, Ngô Đình Diệm is the one who have faith in Catholic, Christianity. So there is a kind of trying to push aside Buddhism and to make Christianity become strong and become a country's main belief. And you can see later on, you can see how the Ngô Đình Diệm regime trying to suppress Buddhism violently. So in Thay, as a young monk, he already see that there is a deep teaching in and the spirit of engaged Buddhism in the Li and the Tran dynasty was playing a very important role to help the country out of a situation. So he learned a lot and he know what is happening, but he always dig deeply into the tradition, into the history to find the jewel for it. So he never just looked down to the history. He always find deep into it. Even like in Buddhism, in terms of Dharma, he always go back to the roots and find the jewels, the beautiful, the teaching that can be respond to the situation of our time. So actually, he have a strong eager and energy and willingness in order to renew Buddhism, but actually he also have a lot of obstacles. The hierarchy in the Buddhist tradition, because there are not always people supporting you, even the high monks in the tradition. So he felt he tried to do a lot, but not easy to get there supported. So he went to Đà Lạt, and he went to Phước Huệ Temple, which is located in Bảo Lộc, Lâm Đồng right now. And then he went to there to practice and to train monks and nuns. And then there he continued to write and edit articles and magazine. And he also with his brother, monks, blood brother, and they set up a first school of Buddhism, just private school of Buddhism, and continue to teach to lay young people and monks and nuns about Buddhism and other study. During that time, he also experienced his mom passed away. So in one way, he was trying to do a lot to renew Buddhism and make Buddhism and then try to reunite all sect of Buddhism in Vietnam to become one. But there was a lot of reluctance. And also what he tried to renew Buddhism, it was not easily accepted. And he was editor of a Buddhist magazine and become very famous, but then he was not supported. And they say that because we don't have enough money to continue with that magazine. But actually, it's the root of that is coming from the hierarchy and not accepting what he's trying to do. And then his mom passed away. So he has a lot of difficulties and suffering during that time. So there was a need to go back to practice and to heal himself. So in 1957, he found a land in Bảo Lộc, Lâm Đồng, and in the highland of Vietnam. And in 1958, he set up Phương Bối, the fragrant palm leaf practice center for him and for his college and other monks to come there and to practice meditation to nourish themselves and to grow deeper into the spiritual experience. And there he continued to write books about and his idea about renewed Buddhism, but he find it, he doesn't have a support how to bring that into the society. So here he shared that he confronted a Buddhist hierarchy about his work and the death of his mother. So he fell into a very, very ill. Yeah. And he got chronic insomnia. And he was hospitalized in Saigon for a month and treated by a French doctor, but his sickness was not cured until he found out that he should practice mindful breathing and mindful walking. And he strongly believed that that can help him. So during that time in Phương Bối, he was practicing full awareness of breathing and mindful walking and sitting every day. And then he realized that he was able to heal himself. And that is why later on and throughout his life, he teach mindfulness as the heart of Plum Village teaching and practice. So he said, with the practice of mindful breathing, I got out of the situation. And then later on, he went back to Saigon and he teach in Sa Lời Temple. And he met Sister Chân Không, Cao Ngọc Phường, and with other 12 young people who are ready to devote their life into helping to bring Buddhism into society. They are called the 13 Siddhas. Yeah. And Sister Chân Không, Cao Ngọc Phường later on became a nun and a very well beloved nun in the international. So he was invited to come and study comparative religion at Princeton, called a theological seminary, during from 1961 to 62 or 63. And he learned, but actually he said that he realized and the wisdom and freedom in the West. And his realization has been put it into a book with his insight and awakening during his time in Princeton University and Columbia. a rose for your pocket. It's about the teaching and practice of dwelling happily in the present moment. And this is the teaching of the Buddha, one of the key teaching of and practice of the Buddha. We should be able to live peacefully and happily in the present moment, regardless of what is happening around us. So he have worked a lot, and then he realized that it is possible to enjoy our life, to live our life freely, happily, and peacefully in this very moment. We don't have to die in order to realize that. And he always said that, in fact, you have to be very alive in order to realize that. If you die, you cannot realize that. Because you're still alert. Everything is so powerful. Your six senses is so powerful. If you cannot realize the path when you are really awake, it's not possible to do it when you are older or after you pass away. So if you know about his first realization, you can read the book, A Rose for Your Pocket. So he studied there, and then he was got the bachelor about theological study. And he was invited to stay behind to continue and to teach about Buddhism in Princeton and in Columbia University. And he decided to do that because he feel hurt already with the National Buddhist Association in Vietnam. Because he have done a lot, but it was not recognized and not supported. So during that time in 1963, the regime, the Ngô Đình Diệm regime suppressing Buddhism very strongly. And Thầy found himself a spokesman for Buddhist movement, peace movement. And he worked a lot during that time in order to help people to understand the situation of Ngô Đình Diệm suppressing Buddhism in Vietnam, and explain why the monks are burning himself to awake the heart of people. So because in the West, people think that he's committing suicide out of desperate and despair and things like that. But he explained to the West that is not the truth. The truth is that the monk is using his body to awake the people, aware that we don't want suffering. We want peace and harmony and so on. So he was able to draw a lot of influence people in the United States and other countries to aware of the situation, especially Martin Luther King. And we also know that Martin Luther King, his people try to ask Martin Luther King not to involve into this. But Martin Luther King, finally he involved into it. And I think that is also maybe one of the reasons why he was assassinated. So in 1964, after the regime, the Ngô Đình Diệm regime fall, then the country was still a lot of things to reorganize, and especially Buddhism. So he was called by a head monk of National Buddhist Association for Thầy to go back and to help him reorganize Buddhism in the country. But the hurt is still there in Thầy. So he was thinking a lot whether he go back or not. But at the end, he think of the people in Vietnam, he think of young monks and nuns, he think of a lot of things that need to be done for the country, so he went back. That's why he wrote a poem say that, okay, I go back with my bare hand. There was a poem in Vietnam like that. In Vietnamese, it's called Xin Ta Ve. I bow my head to return whatever I have in my heart. So and he called himself a foolish monk. A foolish monk. So when he go back to Vietnam and he gave 3 proposals. The first one is to the Buddhist Association, the National Buddhist Association. The first one is to, in the name of the Buddhist congregation, Unified Congregation, we should call the North and the South to put down the gun and then talk about peace and live together in harmony. The second one is to set up a Buddhist institute to train monks and nuns in a very effective way in order to practice, to learn, and to engage in the society. And the third one is about set up a youth of social service, a training center to train lay and monastic skills in order to go out into society to help people to suffer less. Because there was a lot of things that people need help after the fall of Ngô Đình Diệm regime, in terms of economy, in terms of medicine, in terms of education, poverty, and so on. And during that time, people are still having a lot of, they don't have enough knowledge about this kind of things. And so we have to go out there to train the ordinary people to do it themselves. Yeah. But the first one, they refused to do. And the second one, they said, okay, but you do it. Yeah. And the third one, they don't accept. Yeah. But they continue to try anyway, the third one. And then the first one, he wrote an article, a letter, and put it on newspaper. But then after that, the newspaper was banned. The Buddhist newspaper were not allowed to continue because of that. Yeah. So if you don't do it, I do it. So that is the courage of our Thầy. He have the strong courage to do what his heart is, he has his heart feel that is good for the people, for the country, regardless of the rejection of. May I invite a bell for us to breathe? Just enjoy our breathing. Yeah. So he first is trying to renew Buddhism, actualize Buddhism, so that it becomes relevant to society and not just Buddhism in the temple. And then secondly, he moved further into engaged Buddhism, try to bring Buddhism into society. We can practice Buddhism in the heart of suffering and difficulties and not just in a peaceful setting of the temple and things like that. We cannot just sit in the temple and chant and pray while people are dying out there. So he knew that the war continued to go on. Yeah. And actually is still going on. So he need influence people to help to stop the war in Vietnam. So he wrote to Dr. Lee, Dr. King, and explained compassion behind the Buddhist immolation, and explained that he said that nobody here wants the war. What is the war for then? And who is the war for? I am sure that since you have been engaged in one of the hardest struggles for equality and human rights, you are among those who understand fully and who share with all their hearts the indescribable suffering of the Vietnamese people. The world's greatest humanists would not remain silent. You yourself cannot remain silent.
Yeah.
That moved and struck the heart of Martin Luther King, and he was trying to go out there because he was just a struggle for human rights for Black people, but now he moved further and speak out for the injustice of war. And here, during he built a center, Jola, a temple, a center with just thatch and straw and bamboo, and later on become Dharma Cloud Temple, which is still in Vietnam, in Saigon. And there he also set up school of social service. And Sister Chân Không, Cao Ngọc Phường, is among with other six sister and brother, become the first OI member, the OI community, interbeing community. And they are diligently walk out there and help people to suffer less, regardless of the dangers. They can be killed by both sides, the communist and the anti-communist. Among them, there is one sister burned herself for peace.
Yeah.
Nhất Chi Mai. Nhất Chi Mai is her thầy's, one of thầy's OI student. Lay person, she's a woman, and that also struck strongly to the heart of the Western people in the United States. I want to read to you this. If you don't have a spiritual practice, you cannot survive. They explained. And so engaged Buddhism is born in such a difficult situation in which you want to maintain your practice while responding to the suffering. You seek a way, the way to do walking meditation right there in the place where people are still running under bombs. And you learn how to practice mindful breathing while helping care for a child who has been wounded by bullets or bombs. So you see, Thầy is able to bring the practice of meditation into the situation where bombs and bullets are flying around. And that is his his heart. Okay, now I remove this. So Sister Chen Kong, interbeing order of interbeing is a continuation of in Mahayana Buddhism there is a community called lay people, a bodhisattva vows, and interbeing order of interbeing is just another grow from that tradition, but it become more active in terms of helping and practicing in the heart of suffering and in the society. So in 1966, they established the Order of Interbeing. So this is a new community of lay and monastic trying to integrate Buddhism into our daily life, into suffering, to help people to suffer less. And now become very big and is practiced worldwide. And Order of Interbeing has 14 mindfulness training, 14 precepts that people need to receive and to keep and to practice and to actively helping the society. And they also train to become a lay Dharma teacher, to help monastic extend the hand into teaching and guiding people to practice mindfulness. So at Thay Row, the war was first and foremost an ideological struggle. So Vietnam, it was just a ground where the democracy and the communist fight to take power over. To ensure our people's survival, we had to overcome both communist and anti-communist fanaticism and maintain the strictest neutrality. Buddhists try their best to speak for all people and not to take sides, but we were condemned as pro-communist neutralist. Both warring parties claimed to speak for what the people really wanted, but the North Vietnamese spoke for the communist bloc and the South Vietnamese spoke for the capitalist bloc. The Buddhists only wanted to create a vehicle for the people to be heard, and the people only wanted peace, not a victory by other side. Both, he said, the sound of the planes and bombs were too loud. The people of the world could not hear us. So I decided to go to America and call for a cessation of the violence. Peace call. And they were so courageous. He was the first one in the country as a monk to speak about peace. Dare to speak about peace, because during that time, if you speak about peace, you will be killed. Yeah. So after that, he was able to encourage artists and songwriters to speak about peace. And later on, like in Kong Sơn or Phạm Di, they continue to speak about peace. So you can see that one of his courage, he's not afraid of death. Yeah, he can speak for peace and speak for the people. So I remember one time when the September 11, after 11 days, I was his attendant. He went from North California to New York, and he gave a talk at Riverside Church about calling the US to calm down and not to take action and revenge and go to war. And there was a lot of people and his disciple, lay and monastic, say,
oh, thầy, please do not go and do not give a talk because you can be assassinated. Yeah. And thầy smile, say, no, I have to go there. If I don't go there, if I don't speak about, I don't speak out about peace and help the people to not to react and to go to war as prevention, I'm not worthy your teacher. I'd rather die. Yeah. And he went there and gave a talk. And many people expressed their thanks to thầy because they feel the same, but they don't dare to say it. Yeah. They don't dare to say it. So thầy have said it for them. So here, after returning 3 years in Vietnam, the war continued to go on, suffering still very deep in the country, in the people. So he went back to the United States again to call for peace, to call for a cessation of the Vietnam War. So he traveled across US, the US and Europe and Asia, Australia, to speak out for peace. And he had met a lot of influenced people, among them also like Father Daniel Berrigan, Thomas Merton, and so on. Many influenced people to get them help to speak out and to help stop the war in Vietnam. You can read it on our website. And thầy has contributed a lot into the ending of Vietnam War. And during this time, his view of social service and Chùa Lá, his college, his student, lay people were killed. Many of them were killed. And even we don't know where they are killed. Yeah, they were kidnapped and then killed them. And among six of them, one survived. And also he told Thầy about what had happened. And sometimes they said that after they kidnapped six social service and bring to the river, and shoot them. And then before they shoot, they said that, I'm sorry, I don't want to do this, but I have to follow the order. Yeah. And he have a lot of pain and suffering, but he practiced in order to have love and compassion for the situation. And then from 1968 to 1973, he was a representative of Buddhist Association of the delegation to talk about peace in Paris. And the peace were accords, were signed. But after that, they both parties, they tear it, they broke it, and they continued war. And there was many artists and many intellectual people were arrested and put in jail. And they tried to help them to keep the hope, survive in their heart, and continue to write and to educate. So he was sending a lot of little blood packets like medicine and this and that to send in Thay's name. And in 1972, Thay's passport was canceled in the South Vietnam government, and later on, even in the North. Yeah. So since in 1966 he went out to call for peace, and he got exiled until for 39 years until 2005, he was invited back to Vietnam because Vietnam needed to join the WTO, the World Trade Organization, World Economic Trade. So he continued to practice and to support the people, the victim of Vietnam, the victim of the war in of the Vietnamese. And he also hosted the Great Togetherness about environment. And throughout his life until now, he's one of the masters. And Plum Village also is a community we are strongly support in terms of helping to push back the problem of global warming, the climate change. So that's why they came up with a no car day once a week, encourage people not to drive car at least once a week, and then not to consume dairy products, because cow and dairy products, the manufacturing of cow meats also contribute a huge into destroying the environment and create climate change. So that conference was held in Menton in France, and Sister Chen Kong was one of them, and to do that with Thay and Alfred Hassler. And many other hundreds of scientists who come to that conference. And during that time, Thay published the book, The Miracle of Mindfulness. It's a manual meditation book that help people to understand mindfulness and to learn how to integrate mindfulness into their daily life. Like how to practice mindfulness when you are washing the dish, brushing your teeth, walking in the train, driving the car and things like that. And become a bestseller. Up until now, The Miracle of Mindfulness is still very popular. So if you want to learn about that, you can read that book. And so inside 75, he set up a sweet potato because people escaped Vietnam by boats. So he was happening to give a talk conference in Singapore. And he have learned that many boat people come to Singapore, but they push back. Even the storm and the rain and the wind is still happening. So they try to rent boat, the fishing boat, to come and to help to take them into the land. But the government of Singapore was reject them. So they try to contact with the French embassy, and they try to bring the people into the embassy. And one of them was saying that if you are able to put them into the fence, inside the fence, then they are safe. Yeah. And then some of them, but there are so many of them, so they also rent boat and to take them to Australia, things like that. And that is called the Sweet Potatoes program. And after 24, after the government, the Singapore government, learn that they have doing that illegally. They try to push Thay out of Singapore in 24 hours. So even he has still have that 24 hours, he continued to do it to the last minutes before he left Singapore with the help of Sister Chen Kong and her elder brothers and other people. It's not enough just to talk about compassion. We have to do the work of compassion. Yeah. So you don't just talk about compassion. You have to go out there act. Yeah. So after that, he set up a small center in Paris to for him and for his disciples student to go back and practice. But then it becomes so small. People are interesting, and they when they practice, they feel healing and transformation, and the community grow. So that way he went to the southwest of France and found a land there. And he set up a center now called Plum Village, continuation of Phương Bối in Vietnam. Because he always have that call, urge to set up a center where a sangha of lay men, lay women, monastic, laymen, lay monks and nuns, as a fourfold sangha to practice together. And he focused more on the practice of transformation and healing. And slowly, people come a lot. First, the Vietnamese, because they need to practice to transform and heal themselves. But slowly, the Westerners, they come. And until I came to Plum Village in 1994. But by 2000, many, many Westerners come. So his talk, his Dharma talk become more in English, less in Vietnamese. Yeah. And then slowly people all over the world come and practice. So there was a lot of translation boxes. Normally in the summer opening, repeat for 1 month, there was about like 60, almost 60 nationality come and practice. And then slowly, a lot of Western young people come and wanted to be trained as monastics. And he practiced, he teach the monastic, and also he traveled to different countries to continue to share and to help people to practice Buddhism mindfulness. And he have taught a lot about Dharma and Shastra and so on. And then he also spent a lot of time building a harmony community. And so we have learned a lot of the new elements in the West. And then he learned the beautiful teaching and practice in Buddhism, in tradition, in the Vinaya. So he tried to get out a lot of good things that is still relevant for our society. And he dare to remove, to put aside the thing that is no longer effective. That is why he revised the Pratimoksha. He present the sutra in a new language that people can understand, yeah. Especially the young people, because the sutra in the canon is quite difficult for young people to understand. So you have to kind of represent it in a new way, yeah, in a new language. So he started receiving monastic in 1988, before he was so busy of calling for peace and things like that. And he think that if he don't have time enough to train the monks and nuns, he should not receive monastic disciple until he find that he see that he have enough time in order to train them. Yeah. And Sister Chung Khang with other sisters were ordained on the Vulture Peak in India. over his first monastic disciple. So this is the last slide. So he began leading mindfulness retreats in the US, 1988 till the 90s. And his core teaching is about interbeing. Yeah. So interbeing is the insight that help us to let go of dualistic and discriminative thinking, and to look deeply into the roots of suffering in order to heal and transform. This is a kind of new term, and this is a interbeing is a new Buddhist term that is not existed in dictionary yet. Yeah. And this is a term that help people to understand easily the teaching of non-self and emptiness. Because emptiness to the Western people, they are so afraid. Yeah. They're afraid of, they may misunderstand that emptiness is something like nothingness. But interbeing is just mean like you cannot be by yourself alone. You need to interbe with everything else. Just like a flower. A flower cannot be by itself alone. It needs to interbe with the sunshine, the rain, the water, the earth, the soil, the food, the culture, the civilization, everything. Yeah. So when you look deeply into something, into yourself, you can touch that nature of interbeing. And you also touch the elements of non-self, of emptiness in yourself. Emptiness is just empty of a self, but it's full of everything else, right? It's just empty of a self, but it's full of everything else. So that it's easier for people to understand. It's just like you like the left and you don't like the right, and you want to get rid of the right. But as long as the left is still there, the right is there, right? Even if you you cut the part you call the right, it's still the right because the left is still here, right? So with the teaching of non-self and emptiness, you look deeply into the left and the right, and you see that the left is made of the right and the right is made of the left. And the left is the right and the right is the left. If you get angry with your father, and you want to get rid of your father, you cannot get rid of him because you are still there, right? You are the son. So the father is made of the son and the son is made of the father. As long as the son is there, the father is there. So the only, with that insight, you will be able to reconcile with your father and you will realize that you are your father. Even your father has passed away, maybe your father is still there in you, in us. Yeah. That is the teaching of interbeing. So instead of getting angry of your father or hate your father, it also means that you are hating yourself at the same time. Yeah. And this is very scientific now. The scientists can see that the one contains the all. And you have to remove, with the insight of interbeing, you can remove the dualistic views about reality. And with this insight, we can create a peaceful harmony community, harmony world around us. Buddhism without borders. So they try to introduce the practice of mindfulness of Buddhism in a non-local way. So Buddhism is just not a religion, it's a way of life, a spiritual ethics way of life. And that everybody, whether we are Buddhist or non-Buddhist, we all can benefit from this beautiful teaching of one of the very famous teacher in the world, the Buddha. So the Buddha is not a religious person. he is an awakened one, and he found the way that can help us live in peace and overcome fear and violence. And this is a human heritage that everybody has the right to benefit. And we can also learn the beautiful teaching from Jesus Christ as well. And this is why they try to were successful into bringing Buddhism into the West, because he was able to dialogue peacefully with the Christianity and Judaism, because he see the beauty in the religion, the tradition, and they help them to see the beauty of Buddhism. That is why he wrote books like Buddha and Jesus as brother, or Living Buddha, Living Christ. This is a peaceful dialogue between religions, because religion can bring a lot of war and conflicts. Actually, Vietnam War also part of religious war. Also, so when you read the 14 mindfulness training, the 14 precepts of the order of interbeing, you can see why that is the precept born from that conflicts about fanaticism, intolerance, and so on. So every time his life is dedicated a lot into teaching the people how to practice the 5 mindfulness training, the 5 precepts, sila. And he also revised the 5 sila, the 5 mindfulness training, to make it relevant and can respond to the situation of the modern life. And he say that the 5 mindfulness training is the way out for our situation. And the way he presented that convinced the Westerner, even they already have a background of Christianity, Judaism, and things like that, and they still open their heart and receive the mindfulness training and put into practice. And you can see sometimes we have a retreat for 1,000 people, 800 people present themselves in front of the Sangha and to receive the 5 mindfulness training and put into practice. And you know the Western mind, if they see that they can do it, they will take it. If they don't, they don't take it. And sometimes people are only take 3 precepts. The other precept, they feel that they cannot do it yet, they don't take it. And then later on, they come back to retreat and they take the others. And then they also, instead of transmitting the 3 refuges, you know, the Buddha, the Dharma, and Sangha, to the Westerner, especially the people who are coming from different belief, they don't transmit that. They only transmit the 5 precepts. Because for them, when they say that I take refuge in the Buddha, in the Dharma and the Sangha, they feel that they are betraying their own tradition, their own belief. So to help them remove that feelings, they don't transmit to them the 3 refuges. But they believe that if they practice the 5 mindfulness training well, then the Buddha, the Dharma, the Sangha is already in there. You see, because the 5 mindfulness training is the Dharma, is the Buddha, is the Sangha. The energy of understanding, compassion, true happiness, and freedom can be realized through the practice of the 5 mindfulness training, the 5 precepts. And if you read the revised of the 5 mindfulness training, you can see that they said that the core teaching of the Buddha can be found in the 5 mindfulness training, like the 4 noble truth and the 8-fold noble path. Eightfold noble path. The teaching of interbeing can be touched in the 5 mindfulness training. practice. So at the end, in 2011, he signed a partnership, a cooperation together with MOU, with MCU in Plum Village. And you see the picture. I was there as well, standing behind somewhere. And then 2009, he returned to Vietnam, 3 trips. And then he returned back again to Vietnam in 2017 and 18. And then he stayed there until he passed away. So thank you, Mahasangha, for listening to the presentation. I think I have tried my best just to present it. In the afternoon, I will share about the core teaching and practice of Plum Village. But through this presentation, we can feel that Thay's heart, Thay's love, his bodhicitta is in us. And we can continue that hearts, the courage, the wisdom, the compassion, that we can do something to help to make Buddhism become more relevant and practical to our daily life and to help the people, especially now people are confronting a lot of difficulties in terms of pandemic and disease, and also the globe climate change. So his life emphasizes a lot on community life, building a sangha, and to him that without a sangha we cannot do much. As an individual, we cannot do much. As a sangha, a big vehicle of laymen, laywomen, monks and nuns, we can do a lot to help the world. So we can see that Thay is not passing away yet. He's still there in us, in all of us. Just like we feel that the Buddha is still there always. When we are able to be peaceful ourselves, when we are able to be solid, when we are able to feel compassionate, and we can touch the Buddha at any time we want. Do we have time for questions?
Maybe the question asked that we move in the afternoon, and we also can ask the question from the practice in loneliness, or the teaching, the core teaching in loneliness. And now we have a memory, the brother and sister, especially the brother Chen Dangli, can answer any question. Yeah.
But one question I cannot answer. That is romantic love.
Yeah, I'm sure.
I'm a monk.
Now is the time for lunch, so that I reply the glow in the morning session here. And we would like to invite brother and sister in London. Let's go to the Wisdom Cafe to have a lunch. And all other brother in the IBSC student come here in the afternoon at 1 p.m. We continue the ceremony and seminar. This evening in the afternoon, very special program for us. We learn more about the teaching and some tradition from Long Lake tradition. Thank you for your missionaries and cooperation.
That's what you're doing. That's what you're doing. Recording stopped.
Thank you.